A couple of announcements. This Friday night, the 14th at 6:30 p.m., we'll have over here at the sanctuary or in the back, Bible and Burgers. If you'd like to come, there's a sign-up sheet outside. Also, today is the last day to let Miss Marcy or Amanda know about if your kids want to go to camp. That's ages 7 through 11. And also, we have a garage sale that will be held here on the 22nd from 8 to 2 p.m. If you want to donate items for the church to sell, you may start doing so, and we'll store them in the back room.
There's a name above all others, wonderful to hear, bringing hope and cheer. It's the lovely name of Jesus, evermore the same. What a lovely name. What a lovely name, the name of Jesus, reaching higher far than the brightest star. It's sweeter than all the songs they're singing in heaven. Let the world proclaim, what a lovely name. He'll return in clouds of glory, saints of every race shall behold his face. With him enter heaven city, ever to acclaim, what a lovely name. Oh, what a lovely name, this name called Jesus, reaching higher far than the brightest star. And it's sweeter than all the songs they're singing in heaven. Let the world proclaim, what a lovely name. Oh, what a lovely name, this name called Jesus, reaching higher far than the brightest star. And it's sweeter than all the songs they're singing in heaven. Let the world proclaim, evermore the same, what a lovely name.
Thank you, Miss Brenda. We appreciate you. Amen. What a lovely name, the name of Jesus. How many of you know that there is power in the name of Jesus? Amen. Stand to your feet. We're going to continue to worship the Lord. Lord, we give you praise and honor and glory, and thank you for your love, Father God. Thank you for sending your Son to die for our sins, Heavenly Father. We give you all the glory and the praise and honor for that, Lord. Thank you. stay right here in this moment. Just worship the Lord God Almighty. Who was and is to come. He's coming again. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. want to come take the offering up this morning. We're going to do a song for y'all called Let It Roll. It talks about the stone rolling away from the mouth of the grave. Amen. Mr. Ronald, would you pray over it, please?
Amen.
Let worship and justice march hand in hand with the righteous tide of change and the sound of breaking.
I might would have had to change things up a little bit. I'd have had a little dance worked out for y'all. Awfully glad y'all could make it here with us this morning. We're excited to have you with us. We're excited to have you here with us in the sanctuary. We realize about half the church was out at the graveyard this morning. That's all right. We were glad to have them there, and we're glad to have you here with us. Last Sunday, we had our biggest crowd we've had in well over, I don't know, several years, I'm thinking, since then. So we were glad to be able to have that. Can we get the projectors going live up here? Thank y'all. I want to be able to have the opportunity when I come together before you, I always ask two questions. The first question I always ask is what has my God done for anyone in the church this week? Anybody? Amen. 2 weeks of no pain. I think a lot of us would take that. Amen. Amen. Anyone else? Amen. A good report from your doctor. We were glad to hear that. Anyone else? You know, at the same time we bring our praise unto God, I also like to ask the question, who in the church stands in the need of prayer? Who do we need to be praying for this week, sister? Wow. Open heart surgery for your mother. We'll have her in our prayers. Amen. Sister Celeste. An unspoken and tubes for Ellie. Amen. Anybody else have unspokens? We got a few. All right. Sister Cheryl. Amen. All right. Well, we'll continue to keep Charles' blood in our prayers. Two unspoken. Melody? Yes, sir. Paul, we can continue to pray for Paul. I think that's more of a praise than a prayer. We're glad to have Tommy McNabb here with us this morning. Amen. Amen. Quite throughout this year, there have been a few questions of whether he'd make another Easter, but we're glad to have him here with us, and a lot of prayer offered up here for that. Amen. Sister Paula? Amen. Amen. For those of you who know the accident happened in Bunkie the other night, we need to remember the recovery of the McCoy family and remember the loss in the Vaughn family, extended Corley family as well. We want to be able to keep them in our prayers. Who else we need to be praying for this week? Sister? Amen. Amen. We'll pray for your healing. We'll pray for a good report. Anyone else? Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am, Sister Charlotte. We'll pray for the Westbrook family. Yes, we will. Anyone else? Uncle Lionel? Amen. Traveling graces for several people who came in for Easter. Anyone else? Stephanie's here. That's a praise report, and also to pray for continued healing for her there. Like we said, they get that collar on her so she won't lick her wounds. So. Amen. 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 So if all right, we'll continue to lift you up. So they took out vertebrae and fused them. So, all right. So, you know what? Oh, well, that's a lot. You know, Scripture says that you should neither look into the left or look into the right and straight ahead, and I think you've got that now, so we're excited about that. Amen. Anyone else? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you on this most holy of days, and we give you thanks, and we give you praise, and we give you honor. Lord God, we've heard so many prayers that have been answered in this place. Lord God, we see the prayers that have been answered in this place. Father God, even on today, we see those that we thought were dead who are yet alive. Father God, we see those who have had prognosis that they would not make it, but yet they are here. We see resurrection every day, Lord God, through your power. But Father God, into these thanks and these praise, we attach these needs that were brought forward this morning. Father God, we give the needs publicly that you already know about, because Father, next week we want to come back and say, let me tell you what we prayed about. Let me tell you what my God did in that situation. Lord God, we give you the needs so that we can give you the praise when you have answered those prayers. Father God, I pray even now that you lift up everyone here in this sanctuary. I pray, Father God, this morning for the service. I pray, Lord God, for an anointing upon me that my words, Lord God, that I would only give your word. Father God, let everything that is me be taken away and let me only reflect you. I pray, Father God, an anointing on the hearts of all of those here that as they hear your word will take root, Lord God. And Father, we will see a harvest of souls come forth through there. I pray right now, Lord God, all these things in the name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
If you have your Bibles, see if you got a Bible that's got Mark in it, maybe. Let's go to Mark. I want to go to Mark chapter 8 and verse 34. We're going to have communion here in a few moments, but I want to go ahead and give us a few other things here before that. I want to go straight into the Word of God, Mark chapter 8, verse 34. And Jesus summoned the crowd. And Jesus said to them, if anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. And then Paul tells us why in the letter to the Philippians. We must do these things Jesus commanded because Philippians 3:10 says that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death. In the time this morning when we celebrate communion as a remembrance and a celebration for what Christ did for us, a culmination of everything we saw in Holy Week last week, we must always remember that in that participation we show a willingness to not only participate in communion, but to participate in the suffering and death of Christ Jesus. How many of you knew when we signed up with Jesus that we would participate in his suffering and possibly even in his death? Many of us were excited to be able to participate in the salvation and in the gifts and in the outpourings upon us. But how many of us were excited for the sufferings that we would endure? Paul continues in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 16 through 17. He says, the cup of blessing that we bless, is it not a participation in the blood of Christ? The bread that we break, is it not a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one bread. We who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread. We are united this morning in our participation in all Christ has for us and all that he has done for us. And understand, the rewards of Christ, the rewards of salvation are distributed and offered to all of us equally. There is none that can say, oh, I'm worthy of salvation. No. Scripture tells us what? No, none are worthy. We all come to the Christ with the acceptance of his salvation. It used to be said that the only level field was at the foot of the cross. We all come fully expecting his grace, but we must accept that gift. But I've got to tell you this, that the reward is distributed equally, but so is the punishment. So is the suffering. I must tell you today, as I always warn you in the midst of communion, that some today drink from the cup of life, others from the cup of God's wrath. I said, Pastor, how can you say that? How can in communion can you speak of God's wrath? It's because of what we're told in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 27 through 32. The Apostle Paul warns us, therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But a man must examine himself, and in so doing he is to eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks judgment to himself, if he does not judge the body rightly. For this reason many among you are weak and sick, and a number sleep. But if we judged ourselves rightly, we would not be judged. But when we are judged, we are disciplined by the Lord, so that we will not be condemned along with the world. Paul tells us that because of an unworthy acceptance of communion and participation of communion, that he says that some sleep. He means in that some have died. That some have come before and received the communion. They've received what God has to offer unworthily. They have not considered themselves and their sins and taken the time to be able to fully appreciate the sacrifices that were made for them. I have to ask now, if you're willing to sacrifice all that you have, if you're willing to lay down everything that is you, then I ask that you come forward and receive the elements of communion this morning. Please make two lines. Stand up and come over with us. Come and join.
Everything's free.
with me this morning. Father God, I pray that we're found worthy to take of this communion because we realize, Lord God, that we're only found worthy if we are covered in your blood. Father God, everyone who stands in this place this morning has an opportunity now. They are come before you, before the throne. Lord God, we come before you in repentance. We come before you, Lord God, that we are sorry that we have not let your sacrifices be full and complete within our lives. Father God, we have been neglectful of sharing your gospel and your good news with those who are in need. Father God, give us a new boldness, Father God, as we come into this season. Lord God, realizing what you have done, let us share that with others. All these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. On the night before meeting with death, Jesus took the bread and gave thanks to God. Almighty God, we thank you for the body that was broken for us. We thank you, Lord God, for the sacrifice of Christ. We pray, Lord God, even now that you bless us, Lord God, as we bless this bread, this symbol of the body of Christ. Then Jesus broke the bread and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." If you accept that Jesus' body was broken for you, for your healing and restoration, then let us eat. When the supper was over, Jesus took the cup and gave thanks again to God. Lord God, we pray blessings upon this cup. Father God, this symbol of the blood that was shed for us by Christ Jesus. We pray, Father God, that this symbol, Lord God, of the sacrifice made, this symbol of the salvation, Lord God, brought to us by Jesus' blood, Lord God, let it be real to us. Let us, Lord God, begin to further imagine what you have done for us and appreciate, Lord God, what you have done for us. Let us receive this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. If you accept that Jesus' body was broken for you, for your healing, your restoration, if you accept that this blood of the covenant was poured out for you and for your many forgivenesses of sin, if you accept that Jesus willingly poured out his blood on the cross and gave us salvation as an offering for our sin, then let us drink. You may be seated. Thank you to our praise and worship team this morning. Amen. Amen. We still have a seat right here. If y'all happen to come across a drummer or y'all get the urge, just let me know. We could use a drummer. We're thankful for the birth, the life, the death, the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. In those acts, in what Jesus did for us during Holy Week, we see many things. One thing we see is healing. How many of you in here believe that God is a healing God? Amen? Amen. We see it every day. We see it in our midst. In those acts, we see the fulfillment of Scripture. Isaiah 53:5 says what? "But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed." In his death, we find salvation. Ephesians 1:7, "In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sin in accordance with the riches of God's grace." These sacrifices that were made for us, we can never begin to imagine what all was done, what all took place. But I've got to tell you, for all the sacrifices that were done, today is set aside for a day of celebration, for we celebrate the resurrection of the Jesus Christ. We celebrate the resurrection of the Christ. Today the tomb is empty. He is risen. Say that with me this morning. He is risen. How many of you saw that all over Facebook this morning? Or maybe you got early morning tweets or text or whatever you got, and it said what? He is risen. He is risen. Let me tell you, yesterday he was risen. Last week he was risen. The 4th of July he was risen. But how is it that we only recognize a risen Savior on one day out of the year? He is risen. In that one act, we find our blessed hope. We hang our entire faith on the fact that our Savior is not somewhere in a grave. Our entire hope is hung on the fact that that one amazing act of grace in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We see in that resurrection, we see the faithfulness of our Jesus. The fulfillment of what he told us would happen. We see the faithfulness of God in his fulfillment of promises that were made in the garden. Jesus told him, he said, I will be in the earth for 3 days and three nights, right? He told him that, and we see the resurrection. We've seen that power before, 4 days and four nights for Lazarus, 3 days and three nights for Jonah in the belly of the whale. Jesus told us what would happen, and he delivered on what he told us would happen. We see in the resurrection of Christ and fulfillment of what God told us, the promises he made, all the way back in the Garden of Eden, all the way back to Genesis. We read in Genesis chapter 3, verses 14 and 15. It says, then the Lord said to the serpent, Satan, because you have done this, you are cursed. And I will cause hostility between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. You will strike his heel, but he will strike your head. We see the death of Satan, if you will, the death of his power in the cross. God promised us also in Hosea 13, 14, it says what? I will ransom them from the power of the grave. I will redeem them from death. We have no fear of the grave. We have no fear of death. Because that promise was fulfilled to us in 1 Corinthians 15, 55 through 57. O death, where is your victory? O death, O grave, where is your sting? For sin is a sting that results in death, and the law gives sin its power. But thank God he gives us victory over sin and death through our Lord Jesus Christ. Those of us who were up for sunrise services this morning, those of us who are up when the sun began to come through, in the dawn, we saw the first peak of the promises given to us of the Holy Spirit. Today, we begin 50 days until we celebrate Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit came. Whenever that tomb rolled away and that light began to crack upon the earth, there began the countdown to our promise of the Holy Spirit. Jesus himself told us in John chapter 16, verses 12 through 13, when the Spirit of truth comes. When, not if, when the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own, but will tell you what he has heard. He will tell you about the future. Why do we fear the future? We have no reason to fear the future because God has it in its hand. When you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you have no fear of the future because God is going to let you know in his time what you are to expect. And if you're really worried and you don't know what to expect, won't you just flip over to the back of the book here and everything is laid out for you. The Holy Spirit is sent to reveal to you, to teach to you the Word of God. You say, oh, it's hard to read. Yes, the disciples said to Jesus, this thing you say, it's a hard thing. It is. But he said, I'm going to send you a comforter and he's going to teach you. But you've got to get in the Word before he can teach you the Word, right? The song has said, and I've sung it over and over in my head this morning, morning has broken like the first morning. I'm not going to sing the song for y'all. But let me tell you, morning has broken. If you're old enough to remember when Ronald Reagan ran for president back in, I guess that had been 79, he ran, went to office in 80, and everything was going through that malaise that they talked about with Carter, if you remember that. A lot like now. Stagflation, inflation, it was just nothing. Well, they ran a campaign slogan, and Reagan's campaign slogan was simply this. He said, it's morning in America. Well, let me tell you this. It's morning here in the church. Morning has broken like the first morning, like the first dawning. We only come together and celebrate this time on this one day of the year, but every morning when you wake up and the sunshine hits you in the face, you say, thank you, God, for the resurrection. Thank you, Lord God, for the new day. Thank you, Lord God, for the new opportunities you've given me. Thank you, Jesus. I know a guy, he said it took a while. He said he just couldn't get going in the morning. God said, won't you thank me? He gets up out of his bed, stands to his feet, and says, thank you, God. Lays back down, stands back up, looks up, says, thank you, God. Does it 100 times every morning. He said, it would be amazing how that sets your tone for the day. Tell you what, won't you try and get outside and actually see a sunrise? Maybe some of you have missed some of that. Why don't you see what that dawn looks like? Why don't you see what God has for you? We're given in the dawn, we're given that sneak peek into the restoring of a relationship we had with God back in the Garden of Eden. Whenever God, who said what? Let there be light. When you're crying in the night, when you're fighting the things that you're fighting, the depression, the anxiety, go forward, find a way and do like those meerkats do in the morning. What do? They stand out there and just let the sunshine come upon them because they see in that the promises of God. God has promised you yet another day, and God has delivered it to you. God wants us to restore us to the relationship we had in the garden. In the garden, we sing the song, what? He walks with me. He talks with me. God wants that again. Whenever they sinned, he came out hollering, looking for them. Adam, where are you? Eve, where are you? God missed that relationship. God wants that back. God wants that back. How badly does God want that back? Let's go forward to another garden. Let's go to the Garden of Gethsemane. Whenever Jesus already knew the things that were to happen, and he got there, and he began to pray, and he began to pray, and you saw in that point the very pangs of birth. He was going through everything that a woman does when she goes through to begin to give birth. He was there, and he was crying out, and he was under such stress. I'm told that that's the closest a woman ever gets to death is when she is in birth. The body is just pushed to its extreme. Jesus was there sweating blood, and he began to cry out and cry out. And he saw what was about to happen, and he even cried, what? If this cup may pass from me. How many of you have ever said that, Lord God, let me get through, but please, Lord God, if you can take this away from me, take it away. We see that in Jesus on that very night, the agony. But thank God we see the agony prevail the next 4 days, 3 days. We begin to see the tomb open. Just as in birth, we see it pass through the womb. At this point, the pangs of death, the struggle, we see it pass through a tomb. In the womb with a woman, out comes a new life. Whenever Jesus passed through the tomb, he passed into a new life. He passed through the blood that was given on Calvary. He passed through the water when they pierced his side. Everything that needed to take place for a birth took place. And what came forward is a new life, a new Adam, a new promise given to us by God. God said, I give you all this once before, and all you could do, you messed it up. He said, I'm going to give you an opportunity that a new Adam that cannot mess up. Fully God, fully human, but incapable of sin. A true sacrifice made. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Paul tells us, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old is gone. The new is here. If you have accepted Christ Jesus, you are not the old man that you were. The old man is dead. We have come into a new life. You have the chance this morning. Today can be for you like the first morning if you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. If you've never done that, today is the day. Today is the day that can be your new morning. You can walk into that light. It's promised to us. Romans chapter 6 tells us this, verse 4. We were buried therefore with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. Newness of life. How many of you are tired of the old life? It's time for something new. It's time for a new outpouring. It's time for the new wine to come forth, if you want to be able to put it that way. It's time for that newness of life. Both of the churches that I pastor are now sitting under new names. This church now is sitting under the name where the Lone Pine Assembly of God is now the Sanctuary. Marksville United Methodist Church didn't make as big of a jump, but they're now Marksville Methodist Church. They're living under a new name and a new time and new opportunities, a new chance at life. Both of the churches where we are had gotten down to single digits when we started. They were basically, if anyone would have called them, they would have said that they're dead. They said, where do you go to church? I'm over there. They said, oh, it'd be like Martha and say, oh, surely they stinketh. There's nobody over there. There's no life. There's nothing there. And God gave the opportunity because God is merciful. God believes in grace. God believes in newness of life. We see what the newness of life looks like. Last week we had our biggest crowd that we've had. We see that newness of life. You can have that. You can have that new life, but... You mean but? I mean but. You must be willing to do like Jesus did in the Garden of Gethsemane. You must be willing to come forward and go through the anguish. You say, oh, no, I don't have to do that. God's going to pour it out on me. God's going to pour it out on you after you first pour yourself out. When there is none left of you. He will not pour new wine into what? Old wineskins, right? It has to be a new you. You want a new outpouring, then you have to be a new you. Let me put it to you this way. The only thing wrong with you is you. How about that? Say, oh, you're pretty good. He's a pretty good fella. The only thing wrong with him is him. We're like that. The total depravity of man is that they speak of. That is how we were. We must be willing to come to God like Christ did in the garden on the night of his betrayal. You must be willing to pray through. How many of you remember what that even means? Those of us that have been in the church for 100 years, like most of us, we know what it says when you need to say that. You need to pray through. I'm hoping to pray through. To pray through, that means that your prayers aren't just bouncing off the ceiling. You have literally, we used to say, grab the horns of the altar and say, Lord God, I'm not going forward without you. Moses did that in the wilderness. He said, Lord God, we will not go forward without you. These people, Lord God, kill us right here if you're not going with us. To pray through means you need to anguish. How many? Nobody anguishes anymore. They come, oh, Lord God, bless me. Ever the prayers sound like the prayers they do to bless food or now I'll lay me down to sleep. We need to pray like Jesus prayed. We need to struggle like he struggled in anguish. We need to pray like Jesus prayed on that night, the night of his betrayal. To pray through, to make your pleas heard. Let me tell you, come to the altar, pray to God, say anything you need to say. You're not going to offend God, you're not going to hurt his feelings. God's heard it all. Say what you need to say. Whatever it is, Lord God, if you're mad, come to the altar. If you're happy, come to the altar. If you're sad, come to the altar. Whatever you have that is you, pour it out. Whatever it is, God wants to hear from you. We say the relationships end because of a lack of what? Communication. God wants to hear from us, and he wants to speak to you. And the easiest way he speaks to you is through his word. Never sacrifice that. You may have to sweat, cry out, let God know what you truly think. If you aren't happy, tell him. He's a big God. Ask him to take the cup of suffering from you, but never forget your cries, your petitions, everything that you say. That prayer that you're saying ends in what? Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. We pray that all the time. We pray in the Lord's Sabbath, your will be done, your will be done. That is the hardest prayer you will ever pray. You know why we don't pray it? Because we don't want it. Just straight up. A lot of times, a lot of things we don't ask God for because we already know the answer. He's shown us what his will is here in his word. And I'm going to tell you this, you can't be in his word and be in his will. If you're outside of his word, you're outside of his will. His will is here. Pray thy will be done. Once we pray that prayer and we yield, we must be ready for the days to come. The days of betrayal. If you sell yourself out completely to God, you're going to lose some friends and lose some family. Sorry. Straight up. It happened to Jesus. Why wouldn't it happen to you? Be ready for it. Be ready for it. I'm going to tell you this. When things begin to get tough, if you're falling back and depending on the government ain't going to help you. How do I know the government won't help me? Because I never Jesus stood there with the government. Not an offense had he ever done. An innocent man stood there before the government. And the government said what? Truth. What is truth? What's our government say today? Truth. What is truth? What is male? What is female? What is right? What is wrong? You can't depend on the government. The only thing that does not move is the word of God. This does not fail. As dark as the days of persecution may get, never forget, it's not just a cliche. Sunday is coming. Sunday is coming. So many people put that sermon out that the pastor preached. Sunday is coming. Sunday is on its way. Let me tell you, Sunday is coming. No matter what you're going through, Sunday is coming. Today we see the dawn of the newness of life. The evidence of God's restorative power, his goodness is seen here. For the past 2 months, we've been talking about revival, revival, revival. Revival is great. But you know what's better than revival? Resurrection. Sometimes when we seek revival, we're just reviving something that's dead. In resurrection, it is a new life. The old things have passed away. Behold, I've made all things new. Don't you want to see that not just in your church, but in your body, in your life? How about a renewing of your mind? To be given the mind of Christ. It's time for the church to wake up. The dawn is here. Too many people sleep in way too late. Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 14 says, for anything that becomes visible as light, therefore it says what? Awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Awake, O sleeper. I say to the church this morning, awake, O sleeper. Awake, O sleeper. I've taken classes that may not show through, but I've taken classes on how to preach and how to write a sermon. Yeah, I know, you're all in awe like I am. I'm not going to give you my grades. But they teach you when you write a sermon, you have to have 3 points in a poem. Well, by the look of some of your faces, I'm guessing that this sermon to you doesn't have a point. I'm supposed to have 3 points in a poem. So instead, let me give you a very short poem. Oh, Jesus rose from the dead, and you can't even get out of bed. Now, that's more so to the ones that are watching this on the video. Oh, Jesus rose from the dead, and you can't even get out of bed. Some have slept through church this morning in their beds. I passed their houses. They weren't there. But how about this? Others have slept in the pews. Still others are asleep in the church with their eyes wide open. Jesus said, recalling Isaiah, Jesus said this in Matthew 13:14. He said, you will hear. You will hear and you will keep on hearing, but you'll never understand. And you will look and keep on looking, but never comprehend. The church has slept too long. The church has slept too long. Awake, O sleeper. You say, why are you beating us up? We're here. I'm not beating you up. I'm afraid. I'm afraid. You say, what, are you afraid for me? How about this? How about I'm afraid for me? How about that? How about I have the fear of the Lord? And the fear of the Lord brings me to Revelation chapter 3, verse 1 through 3. This is what scares me and other pastors. It says this, Jesus said that to the church, right? I know your works. You have the reputation of being alive, but you are dead. Wake up and strengthen what remains and is about to die. For I've not found your works complete in the sight of my God.
He didn't say you're not doing good things. He said, but your works are not what? Complete. How do I know our works are not complete? Because everyone this morning did not bring someone with them to church. Straight up. Everyone this week did not invite someone to church and say, I will pick you up at 6:30 at your house, and I will be in the driveway blowing the horn until your neighbors all come out, and then I might bring your neighbors to church. That's how I know our works are not complete. Remember then, he says, what you received. Remember what you heard. Keep it and repent. If you will not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what hour. When he wrote these letters to the churches, these letters are first addressed to the pastors of those churches. There are some pastors who should be shaking in their boots this morning because they are not giving the true and complete Word of God. If you find yourself looking and not seeing, if you find yourself hearing but not listening, how about this? How about if you find yourself knowing of God but not knowing God? You can know your Word back and forth and you still not know the Word. There's one passage even more frightening for you. And read that passage in Matthew chapter 7, verse 22. In the words of Jesus Christ, Jesus says, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, we did not. Lord, we did not. Lord, 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 did we not? Did we not do many works in your name? They should have said, we did not. Instead, they said, did we not? Did we not do many works in your name? And then will I declare to them, depart from me, I never knew you. You can know of God and not know God. But if you do not know God, you know what? Today is the day to make it right. What better day than to celebrate the resurrection of Christ and to celebrate the resurrection of your own body and your own spirit? Is there anyone in this church today that can stand up and come down here and be honest with me and honest with God and say, I am not where I need to be. I am not where I need to be. I need to be resurrected. I need to lay down the old man, the old woman, and I need to walk forward for Christ. I need to have that fresh, new anointing poured out of me. I need to be ready for what He has. You can only truly celebrate the resurrection of Christ as if you will join Him when He comes back again. Most all of us in here believe in the birth, the life, the death, the burial and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. If not, we would not be here. But we live our life as though we doubt that He's coming back. Anyone in this building this morning that needs to have me pray with them this morning to accept Jesus Christ or to come back into a newness of life. Anyone. I'm not going to beg. I'm not going to beg. And I've got a roast on. I know the goodness of life that comes through Christ Jesus. We sing a lot of songs at Easter time, and the one I love to sing is, it's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me, and I'm feeling good. That's in Bublé 316, I think. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. Stand with me to your feet this morning. By your actions this morning, you've all said that you are ready for Christ Jesus to return. And I can sleep comfortably knowing that I've done what I needed to do. And I know that you're ready to move forward to do everything to complete the works that He's given to us. Lord God, I pray for blessings upon all those gathered here. I thank you, Lord God, that you brought them into my presence. Lord God, because you have brought them here, Father God. And that nourishes my spirit. Lord, I pray that you give us all a new boldness to be able to share your word, a new understanding of the gospel, Lord God, and a new urgency. Lord God, we give you thanks, honor, and praise on this day of resurrection. For truly, Lord God, as we all proclaim, He is risen. Father God, let that be real to us every day in our lives. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, I pray. And everyone said, Amen. Have a blessed Resurrection Sunday. We'll see you next Sunday as well. We meet here every Sunday, in case you didn't know.